I'm Drew Sawyer, one of the co-curators of Copy Machine Manifestos, Artists Who Make Zines, the first historical survey of zines by artists working in North America over the past 50 years. A zine, short for fanzine, is often defined as a low-cost, self-produced publication intended for relatively small distribution. The exhibition documents zines' relationships to various subcultures and artistic practices such as punk and queercore, as well as feminist art practices. My co-curator Branden Joseph and I have spoken with hundreds and hundreds of artists, and I'm really excited to have two of those artists here to be in conversation with.
I'm Demian DinéYazhi, born to the clans Nastasia, Tabaha, and Tota Chitney of the Diné tribe. My practice pretty much employs a radical indigenous queer feminist framework or ideological base and foundation, while also implementing like a transdisciplinary practice. And so a lot of my work, I think, really just responds to the concepts and like meat of blood and guts of like what the issue is at hand. And then I just figure out different mediums or ways to work.
My name is Joey Terrill, and I am based in Los Angeles, California. I'm a second generation native Angeleno and very proud of it. And I became involved as a student with the Chicano Power Movement and the movement for education in the Los Angeles school districts, as well as La Huelga, Cesar Chavez, Great Boycott. I was a student activist and volunteer, but I fully recognized that within the burgeoning Chicano identity culture that was developing, that it was extremely homophobic. At the same time, I was concurrently involved with the burgeoning gay liberation movement. We were all under the mantra at the time of the feminist art movement, where the personal was political. As a freshman in 1973 at Immaculate Heart College, I was fortunate enough to engage with some other artists from there, one of whom was Scott Armstrong. Scott would do these small edition, like, you know, maybe 50 to 100 of little pamphlets, booklets, that was just a pastiche of different images that was queer, that was sexual. I came to a conclusion, though, by the late 70s, that I wanted to do something more than that for my looking to address our invisibility as Chicanos and as queers in popular culture. I said, what about, I want to do a magazine, and it'll be a magazine that is a parody of all these middle-class magazines that, you know, like House Beautiful. So we titled it Homeboy Beautiful. So we did beauty tips, like Cosmopolitan magazine. We took a white artist, Janet Lementine, and we transformed her step by step into a chola. We took, beauty tips for homeboys and how to fold their bandanas to place them on their foreheads. It was all in fun, but it was also, definitely looking at the homophobia within Chicano or homeboy culture.
I came into zines, I guess, probably in the late 90s. And so I was really fascinated by like riot girl culture. I listened to a lot of Bikini Kill, Slater Kinney. And so I was really interested in the way that, this feminist like subculture was building community. I also realized that I came to it through like the internet. I feel like my interest in like wanting to explore this like subculture came through just like this rigid sort of conservative assimilative agenda. I felt that, you know, growing up, you know, I had to really just hide who I was, like take on this like masculine artifice in order to survive, in order to like escape ridicule or harassment. And that led me to wanting to create my first zine, which was called The Courier Queer. And it was basically, I just, you know, talked to a lot of people on like gay.com or I think Planet Out had like a chat room. I was able to assemble just this small zine that collected voices from all over New Mexico. I realized that it was about wanting to just find other people like myself. I think, you know, a zine was a really great place for me to start that conversation, to figure out like what I was interested in politically, at least at the time. But it also helped me move into other areas that I didn't anticipate that it would help me move into focusing more on like poetry or like visual art. I want my work to reach people, to change people's minds, to interrogate, you know, cis heteropatriarchal settler colonial legacies.
I'm recognizing as I'm sitting here that, you know, starting out in the early 70s to mid 70s, the community was, you know, other Chicanos, other Latinos, but then also the white folks, right? Did our Maricon t-shirts and we marched in the gay pride parade. It was, we were there to show the white gay community, we are here, right here with you, right? But also other Chicanos that, hey, we are here and we are part of the Chicano community, because the Chicano community specifically at that time was based on La Familia, and that La Familia focus just did not include gay, lesbian, much less transgender, bisexual, etc. Then when HIV and AIDS hit, that was a whole another ball game. I mean, obviously, if there was ever going to be marginalized communities, it was people who were most impacted by HIV and AIDS. So for me, I took it as, you know what, this is a war, and I need to be a soldier in this war. And that led to activities related to, you know, things that were being passed around underground, not from the official government. So there were newsletters that were going out. There was the disease pariah news. There were parodies, but there was a lot of information that you couldn't get otherwise. So I look at the zines as a way for information connection to occur, you know, outside of and beyond what the official take is on any given subject or in politics. And they're fun. I just think, you know, I love finding zines. Like, I had no idea this was going on in Saskatchewan, Canada, or, you know, like, oh my God, this punk group, you know, out of Mexico City, like, you know.
Why do you think zines are more popular now than ever with the advent of the internet, right? Which would allow self-publishing and distribution in a lot more affordable ways than the printed, than a printed format.
There's something so powerful about this, about an object, about feeling the paper, engaging with it in this like very intimate way, carrying it with you, passing it on to somebody else. Like, you don't, it's not the same, you know, just sending things off in an email.
To me, it's a very hands-on craft aspect that makes it valuable to me. The other thing is that there are folks that maybe wouldn't have access to a laptop or a computer, but they can get the zines.
Well, thank you both, Joey and Demian, for joining me today in this conversation. I'm really excited for people to come see your zines and your other artworks.
It's been a pleasure, and you know, and meeting Demian here, I feel like I have a new friend. So,
great.
Thank you.
Great. Thank you.